I'm going to read the 9 poems that are in there, and I'm going to begin with a poem that I wrote in 1993 that's called Just Say No to Family Values. On a day when you're walking down the street and you see a hearse with a coffin followed by a flower car and limos, you know the day is auspicious. Your plans are gonna be successful. But on a day when you see a bride and groom and wedding party, watch out, be careful. It might be a bad sign. Just say no to family values and don't quit your day job. Drugs are sacred substances. And some drugs are very sacred substances. Please praise them for somewhat liberating the mind. Tobacco is a sacred substance to some. And even though you stopped smoking, show a little respect. Alcohol is totally great. Let us celebrate the glorious qualities of booze. And I had a good time being with you. Just do it. Just do it. Just don't not do it. Do it. Christian fundamentalists and fundamentalists in general are viruses. And they're killing us, multiplying and mutating, and they're destroying us. Now, you know, you gotta give strong medicine to combat a virus. Who's buying? Good acid, I'm flying, slipping and sliding, slurping and slamming. I'm sinking, dipping and dripping and squirting inside you. Never fast forward a cum shot. Milk, milk, lemonade, round the corner where the chocolate's made. I love to see your face when you're suffering. Do it with anybody you want, whatever you want, for as long as you want, any time, any place, when it's possible. And try to be safe in a situation where you must abandon yourself beyond all concepts. Just say no to family values. We don't gotta say no to family values. We never think about them. Just do it. Just make love and compassion. Merci. And this next poem is called Everyone Gets Lighter. Life is lots of presents, and every single day you get a big bunch of gifts under a sparkling pine tree hung with countless balls of colored lights. The red one with the green ribbon, and the green one with the red ribbon, and the blue one with silver, and the white one with gold. It's not what happens, it's how you handle it. You are in a water bubble human body on a private jet in seemingly a god world, a glass of champagne, a certain luminosity and clarity, skin of air, a flat sea of white clouds below, a vast dome of blue sky above, and your mind is an iron nail in between. It's not what happens, it's how you handle it. Dead cat bounce, catch a falling knife. After endless shadow boxing in your sleep, fighting in your dreams and knocking yourself out, you realize everything is empty and appears as miraculous display. All are in nature, the play of emptiness and cloud. Everyone gets lighter, everyone gets lighter, everyone gets lighter, everyone is light.
Merci.
And next I'm going to read a couple of short excerpts from a long memoir piece that's called The Death of William Burroughs. William died on August 2nd, 1997, Saturday at 6:30 in the afternoon from complications from a massive heart attack he'd had the day before. He was 83 years old. I was with William Burroughs when he died, and it was one of the best times I ever had with him. Doing Tibetan Nyingma Buddhist meditation practices, I absorbed his consciousness into my heart. It seemed like a bright white light, blinding but muted. I was the vehicle, his consciousness passing through me. A gentle shooting star came in my heart and up the central channel and out the top of my head to a pure field of great clarity and bliss. It was very powerful. William Burroughs resting in great equanimity and the vast empty expanse of primordial wisdom mind. I was staying in William's house, doing my meditation practices for him, trying to maintain the good conditions and dissolve any obstacles that might be arising for him at that very moment in the bardo. I had confidence that William had a high degree of realization, but he was not totally, not completely an enlightened being. Lazy, alcoholic, junkie William. I did not allow doubt to arise in my mind, even for an instant, because it would allow doubt to arise in William's mind. Now I had to do it for him. This is a very long piece, and I'm going to skip to another part that's called What Went In to William Burroughs' Coffin with His Dead Body. On Tuesday morning, August 6th, 1997, James Grauerholz and Ira Silverberg came to William's house to pick out the clothes for the funeral director to put on William's dead body. The clothes were in a closet in my room, and we picked out the things that would go into William's coffin and grave, accompanying him on his journey in the underworld. His favorite gun, a .38 snub-nose special, fully loaded with 5 shots. William called it the snubby. The gun was my idea. This, William always said, this is very important. You can never be too well armed in any situation. Of his more than 80 world-class guns, He often wore it on his belt during the day and slept with it fully loaded on his right side under the bed sheet every night for 15 years. His favorite cane, a sword cane made of hickory with a light rosewood finish. Gray fedora. He always wore a hat when he went out, and we wanted his consciousness to feel at ease dead. Black sport jacket, black with a dark green tint. We rummaged through his closet, and it was the best of his shabby clothes and smelling sweet of it. Blue jeans, the least worn ones were the only ones clean. Jockey underwear and socks. Black shoes, the ones he wore when he performed. I thought the old brown ones that he wore every day. But James Grauerholz insisted. There's an old CIA slang that says getting a new assignment is getting new shoes. White shirt. We bought it in a men's shop in Beverly Hills in 1981 on the Red Night Tour. It was his best shirt. All the others were a bit ragged. And even though it had become tight, he'd lost a lot of weight and we thought it would fit. Necktie, blue, hand-painted by William. Moroccan vest, green velvet with a gold brocade trim given him by Brian Geisen 25 years before. In his lapel buttonhole, the rosette of the French government's Commandeur d'Art et Lettres, and the rosette of the American Academy of Arts and Letters, honors which William very much appreciated. A gold coin in his pants pocket, a gold 19th century Indian head $5 piece, symbolizing all wealth. He would have enough money to buy his way in the underworld. His eyeglasses in his outside jacket pocket. A ballpoint pen, the kind he always used. He was a writer and sometimes wrote longhand. A joint of really good grass. Heroin, just before the funeral, Grant Hart slipped a small white paper packet into William's pocket. Nobody's gonna bust him, said Grant. William, bejeweled with all his adornments, was traveling in the underworld. I Kissed Him, an early LP album of Us Together, 1974, was called Biting Off the Tongue of a Corpse. I kissed him on the lips, but I didn't do it, and I should have. And this next poem is a poem that Agnes published in Quanta Irony about 5 years ago that's called Demons in the Details. Once upon a time, these friends loved each other very much. And they made a vow to stay together until they all attained enlightenment. And lifetime after lifetime, and endless rebirths and doing practice, they all realized the absolute, empty, true nature of mind. They were so happy, they started dancing and danced. They were so happy in the shocked recognition of emptiness and compassion. They kept on dancing and danced until they danced away all their flesh and skin, and there was nothing left but their bones. Dancing skeletons, dancing skeletons. Smooth skulls and speeding fingers. Wide-eyed holes and smiling teeth. Sliding femurs and cracking shins. Spinning and sparkling, spinning and sparkling spinal cords. Shouting ribs and singing jaws. Squirming pelvises, shivering bones and shaken bones. I want to jump into your heart. I'm gonna come in your heart from here. When it gets too hot for comfort and you can't get ice cream cones, it ain't no sin to take off your skin and dance around in your bones. It ain't no sin to take off your skin and dance around in your bones. You generated enough compassion to fill the world, and now, resting in great equanimity, you have accomplished the great clarity and great bliss and vast empty expanse of primordial wisdom mind. But our friends were not totally, not completely enlightened beings. And sometimes, 100,000 years in one of the fabulous God worlds or highest heavens is 1 year or a couple of years here in ours. So much for that. Now, at this very moment, each of their consciousnesses are terrified. The bells of hell, the bells of hell, the bells of hell. They have cut off your head and are shitting down your throat. The worst is at this moment happening. The very worst is happening now. Life goes on. This next piece of the words were written by Mark Twain, and I've adopted them into this poem. And they're from a book of his called Life on the Mississippi, from a story that's called Keelboat Talk and Matters. And there are words of a guy called Big Bob, who's doing a boasting speech on a keelboat as they float down the Mississippi River at night, completely drunk and stoned. And he jumped up into the air and cracked his heels together three times and shouted out, "Whoop! I'm the old, original, iron-jawed, brass-mounted, copper-bellied corpse maker from the wilds of Arkansas. I'm the man they call sudden death and general desolation. Sired by a hurricane, damned by an earthquake, half-brother to the cholera, nearly related to the smallpox on the mother's side. Look at me. I take 19 alligators and a barrel of whiskey for breakfast when I'm in robust health, and a bushel of rattlesnakes and a dead body when I'm ailing. I scratch my head with lightning, split the everlasting rocks with my glands, and squench the thunder when I speak. Whoop! Stand back and give me space according to my strength. Blood's my natural drink, and the wails of the dying is music to my ear. Do not attempt to look at me with the naked eye. Contemplate me through leather and lay low and hold your breath, because I'm about to turn myself loose. The massacre of isolated communities is the pastime of my idle moments. The destruction of nationalities, the serious business of my life. The boundless vastness of the American desert is my enclosed property. And I bury my dead on my own premises. Next poem has an Italian title, La saggezza delle streghe, and in French, La saggezza dei sorcieri, and in English, The Wisdom of the Witches. On a cold, early November night, Mimmo, Martino, and I climbed to the top of the Norman Rock Tower at Castel Mezzano. In the green lips of the trees, the Dolomite mountain peaks of Basilicata, big, broken, splintered teeth spiked the sky and a thin crescent moon. Bright white light from the Lumiere show, turned on by the mayor, especially for us, gloriously illuminated the mountainsides. Fog blew in from the blackness. Clouds rolled in below and swirled around us, and exposed briefly by a beam of light, fled quickly, slipped back into the pitch black, and stumbled up and danced down the stone slopes and rushed in to touch, embrace, and welcome. Hidden in the fog and mists were many witches, each a secret to herself. The white witch with the curved knife and the bella figura. The red witch made of ruby with a voluptuous body. The blue witch with an owl face rode a donkey with three legs. And the yellow witch wore a ball gown of gold brocade and held a mongoose vomiting jewels. And the green witch with a hawk face rode a camel, and scorpions came from her fingertips. And the beautiful witch with a smiling face held a lamp of the sun and moon. The witches of fog ate the witches of snow, and witches dressed in black rode white dogs and danced, flew, chased, glided, jumped over, and long dives from life to death. And witches who were rotting in hell swarmed, screeching with joy. They were happy to see us. The witch Santa Muerte was a skeleton with a grim reaper sickle and a blood-curdling grin. She usually wore black, but occasionally liked feather boas and sequin gowns and big fake jewels and necklaces and rings on each bone finger. She chain-smoked cigarettes and joints, drank whiskey straight, and snorted drugs. She had no flesh, but loved sex and bliss. She danced exquisitely the criminal tango. Santamurte answered the prayers of the poorest and most outcast. People in trouble adored her. Whores and drug dealers, car thieves, burglars, and con artists sought her protection. People prayed for the miracle of money for food and the lost and abandoned. Every single one who asked her help, she helped. Santamurte was the wish-fulfilling witch. The witch of poetry was Saraswati, and her sister Lakshmi was the witch of wealth. When Saraswati wrote great poems and sang beautiful songs, filling the world with music and wisdom, and became famous and adored for her brilliance, beauty, and compassion, her sister Lakshmi got very jealous and did the most terrible things. She stole the cash and property, lied, invented false gossip, had her excluded, and had the lawyers sue, blocking everything from happening. She punished her for her success. Sweet revenge. That's why poets never have money. Poets are poor sisters with great clarity and great bliss. Put your ear to stone and open your heart to the sky. Put your ear to stone and open your heart to the sky. Put your ear to stone and open your heart to the sky. Ugly and beautiful witches, peaceful and wrathful witches, increasing and magnanimous witches are the outer displays of wisdom. Witches of water, witches of earth, witches of air, witches of space are the inner wisdoms. And witches of fabulous sex in the union of great bliss are the secret wisdoms. And witches of great compassion and emptiness are the innermost witches. Mimo, Martino, and I climbed back down the rocky mountain path as if feathers were under our feet. And as we walked down below the clouds on steps cut in the rock toward the medieval stone houses that clung to the edge of the mountain peaks, thousands of modulating waves of sweet sound sang in silence. Standing on the corner of Stanton and Clinton, waiting for the traffic light to change. A man is sitting on the steps of a building, holding his young son in his lap. He is eating fried chicken from Chico's Takeout on Houston. He chews on the wings and feeds bits of the breast to his son. The man finishes eating, puts the leftover chicken and bones, French fries and soda can in a paper bag and leaves it on the sidewalk. A brown dog from the neighboring building snoops around, gets his nose in the bag, chews on the bones, and makes a mess. His wife comes home with the groceries and takes the boy into the building. She had been his lover in many past lives and was his mother for the first time in this one. A black cat in a window sits wide-eyed staring down at the dog, Chicken Bones, and Grizzly. I see their past and present lives. The man eats the chicken, and the chicken was his mother who had died 2 years ago of cancer. The dog chewing on the bones was his father who had died 5 years ago of cancer. And the cat in the window was his grandmother. And his young son, whom he holds so tenderly, was the man who killed him in his previous life. His wife comes home with the groceries and takes the boy into the building. The world makes me laugh. Fill what is empty, empty what is full, light as body, light as breath, welcoming the flowers, daffodils baptized in butter, lilacs luxuriously licking the air, necklaces of wisteria bowing to magnolia mamas, the cherry blossoms are razor blades, the snow dahlias sharp as cactus. The lilies of the valley are lilies of fur, lilies of feather, lilies of thin, lilies of skin. The almost Miss America rose. They all smell so good, and I get sucked into their meaty, earthy goodness. I lay my chest head on your chest and feel free, filling what is empty, emptying what is full, filling what is empty, emptying what is full, filling what is empty, emptying what is full. The gods we know we are, the gods we knew we were. I smell you with my eyes, hear you with my mouth, feel you with my nose, see you with my tongue, and hear you with my tongue. I want you to sit in my heart and smile. Words come from sound. Sound comes from wisdom, and wisdom comes from emptiness. Deep relaxation in great perfection. Welcoming the flowers, armfuls of honeysuckle and columbine, red-tipped knives of Indian paintbrush. The fields of daisies are the people who betrayed me. The lupine were self-serving and unkind. The orchids were the tongues that lied. The voluminous, voluptuous bougainvillea are flames licking what cannot burn. The poppies have pockets packed with narcotic treats. The chrysanthemums are a garland of skulls. I go to death willingly with my great comfort and bliss as when I lay my head on my lover's chest. Welcoming the flowers, the third bouquet is a crown of bluebells, a carillon of foxglove. A sunflower snuggles its head on my lap and gazes up at the sky. May all the tiny black insects crawling on the peony petals be my sons and daughters in future life. Great balls of light, white, red, blue, concentric dazzle, yellow, green, great exaltation, the world makes me laugh. May sound and light not rise up and appear as enemies. May I know all sound as my sound. May I know all light as my light. May I spontaneously know all phenomena as myself. May I realize original nature, not fabricated by mind. Empty, naked awareness. And this last poem is called, this last poem I wrote in New York City, and I started in July of 2001 and finished it by the end of that year, 2001. And it's called, There Was a Bad Tree. There was a bad tree, a bad tree that people hated. The leaves gave off a foul smell and the flowers had a bitter stink. If you got too close, you vomit. The fruit was poison. One bite and you were dead. Everyone really disliked the bad tree stunk. They talked endlessly about it and decided to cut it down. Get rid of it. They chopped with axes and barely made a dent. Wearing breathing masks, they whacked at it, nibbled and chipped. Oily powder from the shiny dark green leaves got on their skin, blistered, and was really itching, and they scratched bloody red. They put on protective gear with oxygen and went at it with electric buzz saws and heavy equipment. Working 24-hour shifts, finally they cut it down. Everyone was very happy and celebrated the great victory, a noble deed well done, and they went to bed exhausted. The next morning, the bad tree had grown back, had sprung up, new and bigger and more beautiful and ugly. It was very discouraging. They talked a lot about it and cut it down again and poured gasoline on the roots and burned all the leaves and branches in a big fire. After the smoldering embers got cold, the tree grew back, bigger, more bad, and really gorgeous. Other people had been watching from their houses, waiting their turn. They thought themselves smarter, with higher intellectual capabilities. They knew how to get rid of the tree. It was a growing plant, a wood tree that grew in the earth. They incinerated it, burned the roots with chemicals, vaporizing acids and robotic lasers, detonated on the ground, bombed from the air, hit with smart missiles, and bombarded with radiation. They made a firestorm and covered the ground with concrete and steel. The tree grew back. The wood was harder, darker, more shiny, thick, hot muscle, and the leaves, full and lush, moved like underwater plants, luxuriously in the breeze. It was very discouraging, extremely depressing, a catastrophe. They had made for themselves a hell world. They talked incessantly about it and came to a big decision. The mayor resigned in disgrace, and those who had worked so hard left humiliated, departed, moved to the other side of town, stayed away. Then, out of the blue, appeared these beautiful people. They were simple and humble and a little like peacocks, and seemingly well-intentioned with a great sense of humor. Radiantly relaxed, oozing loving kindness and compassion, they walked right up and started eating the leaves. They ate the leaves and enjoyed them, became happy, and laughed, and chomped on more leaves. You could tell they really liked the taste. They pressed their cheeks to the flowers, black velvet coated with transmission oil. They licked the sweet juices that seeped from the petals. The pollen was coal dust and petroleum gas. Burying their noses, they sucked in deep breaths, eating the smell. Great bliss. They discovered the fruit hidden beneath the leaves. Overripe mangoes with sticky eggplant skin hung like testicles, and inside the fruit was rotting meat like liver. The special people got their faces into the stinking slime and really got into it, inhaling with their lips and teeth and tongues. They licked and drank the thick red juice. The seeds, like cabochon rubies, seemed particularly potent and were chewed with great delight. The fruit contained the five wisdoms. The men and women became luminous. Their skin was golden and their bodies, almost transparent, were clothed in shimmering rainbow lights. They became sleepy, yawned, and curled up under the tree and took a nap. While they slept, music filled the air. Lounging against the gnarled tree trunk and protruding roots, their huge bodies, colored red, yellow, blue, green, white, rested in great equanimity and radiated huge compassion. Inside the tree was the secret home of many demigods, hungry ghosts, and earth spirits, who were very pleased with all the positive attention being paid them. After years of abuse, mutilation, and destruction, they were thrilled, even though they were being ravaged and their flowers wrecked. The beautiful men and women woke up and nibbled on the leaves again. They ate the leaves like deer, pausing between bites, looking up at the vast, empty sky. The leaves and fruit increased their clarity and bliss and introduced the nature of primordially pure wisdom mind.